intimidate.
No, the staff picked me. I finally know who I really am. I've got a costume and everything.
I'm trying to protect you.
Aloha. Welcome to Scintillating Reviews, and tonight we will be reviewing one of DC's original, Stargirl. This episode, this week, was much, much better compared to last week. It kind of had me going up in the giddy sort of feel. Again, when I mentioned last week that there was some kind of prediction of a certain character, while it did happen a little bit this time, there was a character that came into play where I said I did not see that one coming. This video will be in the style of a podcast, so if you want to minimize this video while doing something else while listening to me, that is totally fine. I won't be offended. Spoiler alert is now in effect. When we got started with the introduction of this episode, the intro music got me dancing already. I was already in for a treat when I heard the intro. We start with a normal high school football practice where it looks like it's going smooth until a very late tackle from one of the players caused a little mischief with another football player. The player that got knocked down revealed to us that not only was it a girl player, but also this girl goes by the name of Artemis. We'll get more into Artemis's development later in the season. After a disagreement with one of her teammates, she gives him a fist punch, landing him on the ground. Getting praise from her parents, Mr. Lawrence Croc, or who we've seen at the beginning of episode 1, that goes by the name of Crusher, and Mrs. Brooks, who are sitting on the bleachers, but the praise didn't really come so much from the football coach. The coach leaves for the night when he has a confrontation with Artemis's parents, who are not pleased with his decision on benching her after hitting another player, which, considering coming from the student that deserved to get hit, I saw it as a sexist comment on how she can't do what the boys do, and I support that move from Artemis. Before the coach can say anything, Lawrence raises his baseball bat and takes a swing at the coach, resulting him in an immediate kill. Courtney returns home after recruiting Rick Tyler to be the new Hour Man, only for her bedroom light to be turned on with Pat being in her bedroom. I found this scene hilarious that the Cosmic staff didn't want to be scolded by Pat, so it literally gets away from Courtney's grasp and it hides underneath her bed. I just found that hilarious. What I found interesting is that out of all the items that Courtney took from the JSA, the only one that Pat raised a concern on was the Green Lantern. Pat said that luckily without the ring, that the lantern can't do anything. Pat is hurt that he thought him and Courtney were in this together. Pat confesses with suspicion that Courtney gave the hourglass to Rick Tyler, who is the son of Rex Tyler, aka Hourman, because he says that the truck in the pit had Rick's prints all over it. It had proof that Rick was the one that punched the truck in the first place because of the super strength coming from the hourglass. Courtney then adds on that Dr. Midnight, Pat leaves Courtney's room. Seriously thinking the way a parent talks to their child, that even though they don't respect him, he thought he was much more than what was happening now. Pat takes all of the items and places it in a chest as he pulls out Rex Tyler's journal, looking at an old photograph with Rex with a 66 yellow Mustang. The one item that he did not see was the oh-so-famous and dangerous pink pen that's still sitting in Courtney's room. I would like to see a little bit more development on that pink pen later. Moving on to see Jordan, or Icicle, we see him suddenly waking up from sleep, which tells us it could be a nightmare, and this nightmare involved the flatlining sound of his wife passing away. He receives a text message from Principal Bowen stating that, quote, the gym rats are at it again. Jordan gets dressed and ready to leave for work. We see him talking to his son Cameron, saying that today is a hard day. Jordan just smiles and tells his son that it is okay and go back to sleep. In the woods, we see Mrs. Brooks and Crusher, who I'm going to refer as from now on, burying the coach that they killed. Behind them is Jordan, stating that he is tired of what the two are doing, and he's pretty sure that Artemis is feeling the same way, and tells the pair to put their suits on, as they're back in action now. Back at Courtney's home, not part of the story, but I just find this a funny little scene where we see Mike building an unusual chocolate candy volcano created with sugar, and just so much sugar with that volcano. Rick is walking to school when he runs into Pat, telling him that they need to talk, and that Pat knew his father. Yolanda and Courtney meet in the gym as they were talking about a boxer that was able to redeem himself, and that if Ted Grant can come back, then so can she. Talk about a gut punch when you need to say something and someone says so special that makes you feel good that it was all thanks to you for making their redemption happen. You can't really take that away from that one person. Courtney meets Beth in the library having a little chat with Chuck, or Dr. Midnight, as Beth thanks Courtney for the goggles and how grateful Beth is to Courtney as Beth hasn't met anyone like Chuck before and how he's the only one that would listen and talk to her. In the pit, Pat and Rick are talking about the punch that Rick inflicted on his uncle's truck, and Pat says that he could use Rick's help as he hands him a journal, the journal that belonged to Rick's father. Courtney sits with the girls at lunch and tells them that they need to give Courtney the props back. Yolanda and Beth were obviously not okay with that decision as they both get up and leave Courtney alone. Back at the pit, Rick is going through the journal and doesn't find anything that would help. He's ready to leave with the hourglass and the journal, but Pat says that it's not a good idea and that he's not ready for it, as he knows Rick has abused that power when Pat knows on how addictive that kind of power is, and that's why Hour Man only limited to 1 hour a day with super strength. Hour Man was the one that invented the hourglass. Rick gets all upset with Pat's words and asks the question, which seriously is a kick to the teeth to Pat. Quote, if you were Starman's sidekick, what the hell did he use you for? Because as far as I can tell, you don't do anything, as Rick walks away. We watch now where we see a new football coach is introduced and we see Artemis' parents sitting on the bleachers as they have a little chit-chat with CFO Stephen Sharp. He hands them an Empire Enterprise ID, stating that they have the broadcast equipment, now they need the satellite codes, and everything is set up and ready to go for new Project America. Making it to Blue Valley Middle School, now we get to see the middle school science fair where we see other students' parents come in and observe other students' science projects, where Mike shows off his chocolate volcano. I love how sweet that scene is between him and his stepmom Barbara. I thought the volcano was gonna go the way that it shouldn't have, but it actually turned out really awesome, so kudos to Mike for that. Courtney is still trying to push Yolanda and Beth to give the equipment back, which is still a bus. They run into Rick now. He's asking Beth what the equations mean in Rex's journal. Chuck unfortunately doesn't have any record on the formulas, but an alarm has gone off at Empire Enterprises System, which is a communication company. The arch enemy that is hacking the system is somebody that goes by the name of the Gambler, which awfully looks a lot like CFO Stephen Sharp. The Gambler is somebody who is more behind the scenes hacker with a mastermind brain. He's wanted for fraud, conspiracy, and murder. Courtney thinks it's a good idea to tell Pat, but Rick, Yolanda, and Beth all want to go after him. As he doesn't have unusual superpowers and super strength, he's just very intelligent, he's just very smart. Courtney gives up and tells them that she's going to. We meet Artemis and her parents at home. Mrs. Brooks and Crusher tell her that they're doing date night, and this was a obvious whatever inside Artemis's mind, as she knows that they've never done date night before. So with the way that we're understanding Artemis, she's not a very dumb person. She's smart. She's very smart. We see the teen quartet outside all suited up in their uniforms as they enter inside the Enterprise communication building, preparing for their first fight with CFO of American Dream, Stephen Sharp, or in the ISA, he's known as the Gambler. Inside, the teen heroes first walk in and see a dead security guard who was not caused by either the Gambler or the teen heroes. This is where we see Sportsmaster and Tigress, who in a way, they work for Icicle. This is where the action finally kicks in as we see fight montages between Sportsmaster and Tigress and the teen heroes. After 6 episodes, I'm finally happy and relieved to see that we can see a fight scene coming in between Stargirl and now her new sidekicks, Dr. Midnight, Hour Man, and Wildcat. I love the choreography, I love the fight scene. It was really good. Actually, while I was writing this, I was so intrigued, I just kind of stopped writing a little bit on what I was going to say. When all hope seems lost, Stripe comes in the battle, and before it gets too out of hand, Sportsmaster and Tigress flee the scene. Courtney and Pat had a little heart-to-heart where we see Pat and Courtney just speak like, whoa, they didn't listen? Yeah, I tried and nothing was like working. Oh, I see what you did there. Pat finally got into Courtney's head where he was telling her the exact same thing that Courtney was trying to tell Beth, Yolanda, and Rick. In the end, Pat has accepted the teenagers to be Courtney's new teammates. In the ISA meeting room, Stephen Sharp explains that they have the equipment Dr. Ito requested and the satellite codes, but now they're missing Brainwave. Jordan explains that now they need to see who this new set of superheroes are if the real ones are dead. This comes to the conclusion of episode 6, so we already know for sure who our main cast of villains are. The ISA consists of the, quote, romance duo of Sportsmaster and Tigress, who are Artemis' parents, CFO of the American Dream, Stephen Sharp, who is the gambler, Henry King, who is Brainwave but still in the coma from the previous episodes, and Jordan, who is Icicle. And I'm gonna play the safe bet that he is leading the IJA. Will we be seeing anything more about the Green Lantern, as we are missing a big part of the Green Lantern and how it can't really do anything without its ring? So whoever the new user may be may make an appearance probably by the end of season 1 or the beginning of season 2. I feel like it could be something that may have Mike's involvement. No word on the Pink Thunderbolt pen yet. I would like to see a bit more of that and how it just giggled when Courtney picked it up with the rest of the costume and equipment. If I'm understanding Thunderbolt correctly, to my understanding, and let me know if this is wrong, I guess it was a genie of some kind? I don't really know. I can't really explain it yet, but I'm just gonna play it with a safe bet, as that's all I know for the Pink Thunderbolt pen. I hope it has an involvement at least within the next 3 episodes. This episode was much better. I really like seeing more screen time with Yolanda, Beth, Rick all together, and how they have embraced their new powers and how they have embraced their new superhero persona. If I have to rank this episode between 1 being meh and 5 being totally awesome, I have to give this episode a 4. It was much better compared to last week's episode. Last week's episode, it just kind of got a little bit on the boring side. I gave this episode a 4 because now we have the introduction of Artemis, and Artemis is going to play a huge role in the upcoming episodes of Stargirl. But that is it for the review of Stargirl episode 6. Thank you guys so much for stopping in and just taking a listen. If you're interested in more Stargirl reviews, click on that bell to be notified for personal videos or all my videos. If you want to see more of my content, click on that subscribe. If you like this video and want to help stimulate your reviews, click on that like button and comment your thoughts and theories of what's to come next. Thanks so much, and we'll see you guys next week for the new episode of Stargirl. Thanks for watching Let's Review with Cinelina Reviews. If you want to read the full article of the review, click on the link down below. And we also have a Facebook, Twitter, and follow me on Instagram at CE Madison. Our simplest prevention is our biggest protection. Take care of yourselves and others as you practice social distancing, washing hands, and staying at home. Let's get better by starting to make our world better to reduce the spread of COVID-19. See you later on another day!